Generally, what I like to look for in a bow is comfort. Is it comfortable to hold? Does it feel good when I draw it across the string? A lot of bows might be heavy at the frog and light at the tip, and that's a consideration. You want to be able to, I mean, they will be generally heavier at the frog than the tip, but some are really frog heavy and really tip light, so you want to avoid those extremes. You want to be able to get a good even tone when you draw the bow across the string. You also don't want your bow to spring or chatter when you just draw a normal bow, but you want to be able to bounce the bow in a controlled way when you want to. You don't want your bow to be too stiff, and you don't want it to have a mushy or soggy feel when you play.
Again, when choosing a bow, I'll do the same consideration. You want something that works in your budget. There used to be this rule of thumb that you put 25% of the value of the instrument in the bow. It's a good rule of thumb, but generally, you know, on a student bow, you can find a very nice bow in the $400 to $600 range. You can find a nice, and you know, sometimes you find one that's really nice in that price range, and then they go up from there. The other thing, of course, today we have bows that are made out of synthetic materials, carbon fiber bows, and they can be a little bit more less expensive. They can be a little more expensive. There's some advantages there in that they can be less expensive and they're very durable, especially for situations where you might be prone to break the bow.
Yes. How many times did you repair my wooden bows?
Right. You know, it depends on, you know, so there are some pros and cons, but I don't necessarily say that, you know, a carbon fiber bow is better than a wooden bow for a given price, but you know, that's another option that's available today. So once you've determined a price range, you want to be within. Again, most violin shops you come in and will lay out 6 or 8 bows in that price range, and play through 2 at a time and gradually narrow it down. And again, if you've picked out a couple violins to take home with you, pick out a couple bows to take home with you too, because no bow is going to play the same on each instrument. Some instruments just given the way the instrument is set up and adjusted, and that particular violin, the tension on it, and that one bow will play different or feel different to you on a different violin.
Speaking about tension, would you like to address the tension of the bow?
That's
here?
Temperature
and humidity.
That's one thing that's almost the first thing they ask is, how much do I tighten the bow? Well,
and why do we tighten the bow anyway? Why do we have an adjustment for it?
For the most part, you want to adjust the bow so you can almost get a pencil through here. That's about the rule of thumb on most bows. And then when you play, you shouldn't be touching the stick of the bow to the string all the time. I mean, it'll happen when you're playing really loud and aggressively. And so you sort of adjust the tension of the bow that way.
And Peter just did something you should never do. But he can do it because it's his bow and his bow hair. But
right. And that is, you don't want to touch the hair of the bow. And I was using the back of my finger. But you want, the hair will suck any oil or grease or dirt from your hand onto the hair, and then it just creeps along the bow. And once it gets oil on it, then the rosin won't stick to it.
And you'll have a slick spot
right
in your bow, so you'll be playing along, you go, da, da.
Right. The hair on the bow, if you magnify the hair, it has like scales on it. And those little scales are what holds the rosin to the hair.
This is horse hair, right?
This is horse hair.
Okay. Don't get nylon hair.
Right, the nylon hair doesn't have those little scales, and so the rosin doesn't adhere to it as well. The rosin is what gives the friction between the hair and the string. So if you've ever played a bow with no rosin, you there's absolutely no sound. So the rosin creates the friction. the hair itself, it comes in different qualities, but for the most part, you know, we only use the best quality we can get. And
which I appreciate.
Well, it's getting more and more expensive these days, but the hair, the interesting fact is the hair, like your own hair, it absorbs moisture, so it's to a certain degree is affected by the humidity. When it's humid, the hair actually stretches and becomes longer, and then when it's drier, the hair actually shrinks. So oftentimes we're in Houston, which is rather humid, and we'll have somebody come in and say, I'm going to Colorado, I'm going to Aspen for the summer. Well, we know that when they go to a dry climate, the hair is going to shrink. So we'll rehair the bow, making the hair a little bit longer, because when you go to a dry climate, it's going to shrink. And the other extreme is somebody comes in from New Orleans and, you know, we're going to rehair the bow tighter because you're going to a really humid place, and the hair is going to get longer there.
Does temperature affect it?
It does to a certain extent, but it's mostly the relationship between temperature and moisture in the water.
Okay. If you break a hair, you should pull the hair against the frog, or in the
right
direction against the tip, so you don't pull the rest of the hairs out with it.
The hair is tied in with string at the end, so it's like a bundle of straws. And so if you just pull it out this way or this way, you can pull the hair out of that bundle of straws, and if you take a few out, and then all of a sudden they'll all go loose. So you want to break the hair in a way that's not going to pull it out of the knot. So most people, you break it off to the side, or even better yet, use your nail clippers and cut it. But you know, most people, when you break a hair, you're in the heat of a performance or something.
You're done.
Right. If you're practicing at home, you can use your nail clippers. Going back to choosing a bow, you know that no two bows are going to be alike. Again, you're dealing with a natural material, and the way they're shaped affects how they play.
Assuming you have a wooden bow.
Right. Assuming it's a wooden bow. And so you want one that's, you know, the balance of the bow is important. How it feels in your hand. Does it feel tip heavy? Does it feel real light? If it's light at the tip, then it may be heavy at the frog. And so the balance of the bow is important.
And as you draw it along the string.
Right, right. And then the other thing people often ask is an octagonal bow different than a round bow? And the answer is no. If you had two perfectly, which we can't do except in a synthetic bow, two pieces of material or two pieces of wood that were identical, the octagonal bow is going to be stiffer, up to 20% stiffer than a round bow. And in fact, when a bow is made, a handmade bow, they all start out octagonal. And then as the maker is working it, he says, well, if the wood itself is stiff enough, then I'm going to knock those edges off and make it a round bow. But see, from here on back, the bow is octagonal. And you mentioned about adjusting, and why do we have to adjust it? Well, we have to adjust it to put the tension on the stick by turning the screw, that puts the tension on the stick, and then when you're done playing, you want to loosen it to release the tension on the stick.
So the tension on the stick makes it go from a curve to a less of a curve.
Right.
And by doing so, it puts tension on the hair?
Yes.